Welcome to Second Listen Saturday on the Parenting Roundabout podcast, where we share some fun moments from a past episode for your weekend listening pleasure. Look for new episodes every Monday through Friday. We thought we would talk today about how one transitions kids from you, from mom being the person who is in charge of their health, to them being in charge of their own health, which as they get to be teenagers and young adults, they're really supposed to be. You should not still be going with your 26-year-old to the doctor and talking for her, right? I'm not supposed to be doing that. And yet. So I thought I'd talk to you guys. You have kids who are getting into that age where they're supposed to advocate for themselves and where the doctor is supposed to like close the door in your face and talk to them about sex and things. Do your kids talk to the doctor or do you still have to be Dr. Mom impinging on those appointments?
I'm still in the room during the appointments.
In the room where it happens.
In the room where it happens. And I used to always take my two for their annual checkups at the same time because mm-hmm. their birthdays are so close together. So their annual checkup would be, you know, held at the same time. But I finally, a few years ago, was like, I think I really need to let my like almost teenage daughter not have to share her appointment with her little brother.
Yeah.
So that was step one was mm-hmm. let's separate the two of them and give them each their own appointment. But I'm still in the room for the appointments and they're pretty good. The doctor and the nurse are pretty mm-hmm. good about trying to talk to the kids directly instead of going through me. But, you know, a lot of times the kids just kind of look at me like, I don't know, do you know the yes, answer to that yes. question? Like, you know, how much milk do you drink in a day? They look at me.
Yeah.
Like, well, I don't know how much milk you drink. I'm not with you all day.
Yeah. You are the keeper of the answers.
Yeah. And I know that that's probably not the way to go.
Yeah. I just don't know how you pass that on. I mean, my kids are not great at communication. They never have been. So I've always been kind of speaking for them. Because if you bring my son, he's the only one talking to the pediatrician, nothing would happen. Or he would talk about her keys for 45 minutes. So I kind of have to go in there and make my presentation. And even now that they're adults, I have a hard time. I had my daughter go to our GP and I said, you go in there and you talk to him. Here's some paperwork you can bring to show him that would give him some information. And even then he came out into the waiting room to talk to me. So it's like, I am obviously not doing a good job of enabling them. How about you, Nicole? What do your kids, does your son just take care of that by himself? Does he even go to the doctor? Do you know?
Yeah, I started having him, you know, make that step when he was about 16, 17.
Yeah.
So he didn't have a pediatrician at that time. It was just a general family doctor. So anyway, so he started taking himself to the doctor. And then, of course, if I needed to be there for anything, like for permission or, you know, for tests or anything, then I would show up. But so he's been doing that on his own. And he does go to the doctor regularly just for, you know, we'd like to keep on top of skin issues because of the sun down here. So I make mm-hmm. him go to the dermatologist every year. And then I still make him go for a checkup every year. So I don't know when and at what point I will stop reminding him. I probably never will stop reminding him to go. So. But my daughter, interestingly, though, when we first met her pediatrician, and I remember thinking, this is so rude, but the doctor would only talk to my daughter.
Yeah.
Like she would address me and she'd be, hi, how are you?
Uh-huh.
And then she started asking my daughter questions and, you know, talking to her. Anytime I tried to say something, she'd kind of look at me with this like, sigh. And look back at my daughter. And so what has happened over time is that my daughter now has a very good rapport with her and is used to talking to her.
That's great.
So she, you know, and I do have to thank the doctor for taking that that stance of I'm going to encourage my patients to talk with me. And so she's basically trained my daughter to have conversation with her. So
that is ideal. I wish more doctors did that. We always had doctors who would just turn to me. And it may be because of my kids had communication issues, but I really, really want, I mean, I feel like now that they're adults, I want to find them a doctor who's going to listen to them and who's going to be comfortable with that. And I haven't, and I don't know how you seek that out, especially for kids mm-hmm. with disabilities. You know, people who are used to working with kids with disabilities, I feel like often just don't take their healthcare seriously. You know, it's like, well, okay, you know, it doesn't really matter for her. So I don't like that. But somebody who's not used to working with people with disabilities doesn't want to have to do the work to understand the speech.
No.
So it's really difficult. But I would have loved having someplace that is saying, Mom, you sit over there if you want to, but I'm going to talk to your kid.
Yeah.
That's not happened. That is a very, very good thing. Even though, as a mom, it makes you feel like, hey, wait a minute. Wait.
Yeah. But and that's initially, that's how I felt. I was like, oh my gosh, she's not going to tell her everything. She's going to miss things. But, you know, eventually, and thankfully, the pediatrician brought the issues out of my daughter. And,
yeah.
And they were to have that conversation. So, yeah, I'm really thankful for that particular doctor and her group, because they all do, you know, they all have that philosophy of having the child speak for themselves.
Right.
But I was just thinking, you know, she's going to be 16. I should probably start weaning myself away from the having her go in by herself. So
my daughter's 10 years older than that, and I would like to do that.
But as I mean, I've had this issue. My kids don't want me to not be there. So how do you balance that with like, okay, I know you want me to be there, but it's for your own sake. You know, you need to try to do it by yourself. That's hard too, especially if maybe they're nervous about being at the doctor in the first place.
Yeah, that's true. I feel like you should maybe be able to like email the doctor with all your comments, or like write them out on a piece of paper and send them in with your kid so that you can still be there without like physically being there.
That's a good idea. Writing it down.
The last time I went to, I took my son in and I wanted to talk to the doctor about him, and I didn't want my son to hear what I wanted to say. So I called first and told the nurse, you know, like, here's what I want to do, or here's what I want to talk about, so that I don't know how well it worked. It was okay. I think the doctor generally got the information that I wanted to convey.
I've done that too. I've like told my daughter, I'm going to give the doctor this document. Is it okay with you? And she says, fine. And when I hand it to the doctor, I kind of point to the part that I want the doctor to notice that I don't want to say out loud. There should be some, in our brave new technological world, there should be some way for us to be in the room without being in the room.
Yeah, I mean, I guess more doctors are doing email and, you know, online communication, which ours, it's like a whole thing with logging in and knowing your password, all this. Like, you can't just open up an email, you know, on your desktop. Yeah. You know, you can't just tap out an email and send it. It's like a whole thing where you have to be a member and you have to have a special ID and password and all that stuff.
And I know there's patient confidentiality issues too. You know, if you've ever tried to, well, neither of you have had, well, maybe you have, Nicole, try to deal with the insurance of a young adult, and my kids don't want to call and ask about their claims, but it's like they have to get on the phone and say, yes, it's okay, you can talk to my mother. You know, so I feel when they say, I'm sorry, we can't talk to you about this, I feel like saying, you know what? Great. I'll put my kids on the phone. Work this out with them. Have a good time.
Right. Enjoy.
You're going to be begging to talk to me, lady.
Enjoy their particular communication needs.
That's right. But I think, I mean, any kid, any teenager, you know, or any young adult is probably not going to be able to articulate to the insurance company exactly what they want to talk about.
Yeah.
So, you know, I am the case manager. There needs to be some certification for mothers as case managers to have some legal standing.
Yeah.
To be able to talk to the doctor directly and be able to talk to the insurance company directly.
Or at least some kind of nice, you know, business card or title.
Yes.
If you can.
Yes. Do you guys have to, how do your kids feel about going to the doctor? Do they go willingly, or do you have to push? Nicole, when you tell your son to keep going to the dermatologist, does he ever say, you know what, don't feel like it, go away?
Mm-mm,
I get a lot of that.
Because I successfully passed my health anxiety on to him.
Oh, gosh. I don't seem to have done that. I have passed many other types of anxiety onto my daughter, but health anxiety, she's like, no, I don't want to. And it's like, well, I can't really force you, but I really, you know, and then how do you say, really think you should do this without then making them worried? You know, don't want to panic you, but we go to doctors. This is what we do. This is why we have insurance. It's not a big deal. Just go.
It's sad, but we had a real rash of unfortunate illnesses in our world. And so I think my kids, obviously they saw that, they heard about it. So they're all a little bit, you know, we're all very aware of being preventative to some extent.
Maybe just sit them down in front of a few episodes of Grey's Anatomy and they'll want to go to the doctor.
Yeah. So no, they're pretty good. My son will even book his own appointments. If I say it's time for your dermatologist appointment, he'll book it himself. So he's
awesome. But you have to say it's time.
Well, yeah. I mean, he's still only 20, right? So he hasn't really taken on that. Only 20.
Speaking of only 20, this is a topic for another episode, but we'll go out on this. How much do you have to push your husbands to go to the doctor? And would they like you to go to the doctor with them and talk to the doctor for them? Because I'm pretty sure my husband would if I offered.
My husband's okay. He's pretty good about it, actually, I have to say. Yeah. He'll go.
They manage their own medical
issues.
Now, will
he listen to what the doctor recommends?
Yeah, that's another thing.
Different story.
My husband never wants to go to the doctor for anything. And I remember one time he had the flu and he was really sick and he said, okay, call the doctor. And it was the doctor's day off. And I left a message on his answering machine saying, my husband never wants me to call the doctor and he did today. You have to call me back. And he did. And it was, you know, he just called in a prescription. It was no big deal. But it was like, this is my big time. I can do it. And you're not available.
You're messing up my perfect opportunity here.